They're called snowflake children.
She was the most beautiful baby I'd ever seen.
Find out what makes them unique.
She's like, that was you. You were frozen. You were a frozen seed.
Plus,
you're not a cop. You look like Superman.
He had the looks, and he knew how to use them.
How many notches can I get?
See what caused this bodybuilder to break down.
Anger and hate in her eyes like I've never seen before.
Well, welcome, folks, to this edition of the 700 Club. It looks as if chaos is reigning in Iraq. The country's falling apart. The ISIS is gaining ground, taking more cities, taking the key choke points between Iraq and Syria. And the United States seems clueless. So the Secretary of State is in Iraq today trying to prevent that country from falling into an all-out civil war.
His visit comes as Islamic terrorists are not only taking control of more and more of Iraq, but also spreading Sharia law. Ephraim Graham has the story.
At least 70% of Anbar province is now under the control of militants from ISIS. The jihadist group is on a mission to create an Islamic State across Sunni areas of Iraq and Syria.
The Obama administration believes Iraqi faction leaders need to come together to stop ISIS from taking any more territory. It's a message U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry is sharing today with Iraqi Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki.
The Obama administration believes that Iraqi's faction leaders need to come together to stop ISIS from taking any more territory. A message U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry is sharing today with Iraqi Prime Minister Nouri al-Maliki.
This is a critical moment where together we must urge Iraq's leaders to rise above sectarian motivations.
In the meantime, the U.S. is sending 300 military advisors, but Iraq says what they need are American airstrikes.
We have an agreement which say whenever the new Iraqi democratic government is threatened, America is ready to help.
Many Republican lawmakers also want President Obama to order an air assault.
I think that we should cut off ISIS's access to their command and control structure in Syria. And I think primarily that involves air power.
Be realistic about the nature of the threat. When we're arguing over 300 advisors, when the request had been for 20,000 in order to do the job right, I'm not sure we've really addressed the problem.
But the Obama administration says the Iraqi leaders must start working together before any kind of military solution can be effective. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Well, the truth is the Iraqis have got to get rid of Maliki. He's been an absolute disaster. He is very partisan. He is brutal, dictatorial against his enemies. He's set up what amounts to a Shia state and shunned the Sunnis. And these ISIS people represent Sunnis. And the majority of the Arabs in the world are Sunnis, not Shias. And so he's set himself up for a huge disaster, and we haven't done anything about it. We had the opportunity of having a status of forces agreement, but we didn't take it. Well, here at home, leading conservatives are warning that America needs to change direction away from the policies of the current president. John Jessup has that story from Washington. Here's John.
That's right, Pat. Louisiana Governor Bobby Jindal blasted President Obama and other Democrats, saying they're waging wars against religious freedom and education. And he said a rebellion is brewing in America against Washington. Jindal was just one of the speakers at the annual conference of the Faith and Freedom Coalition, where leading political figures came to speak in front of a very important voting bloc, evangelical Christians. David Brody has the story.
One by one, they came to this stage, weaving a message of faith and freedom. Some of them were possible presidential candidates, like New Jersey Governor Chris Christie, but others, like the new majority leader of the House of Representatives, Kevin McCarthy, well, he came here preaching a message of conservative unity, despite the disputes over the direction of the party between the Tea Party and establishment conservatives. Backstage in our exclusive interview, McCarthy played up the harmony theme.
First and foremost, I want to make sure that we're united, but we want to change the country. We want to change the direction. I want to restructure government itself. These agencies have become too large. They need to be streamlined. There's too much duplication in it as well. We want to unshackle what has held us back for so long.
McCarthy and GOP leadership in both the House and Senate will also have to confront a divide on what to do in Iraq. Some lawmakers, like Florida Senator Marco Rubio, feel like decisive military action needs to be taken. Other Republicans aren't so sure they want to get involved in this fight. Rubio told us that's a mistake.
They're wrong. We're going to have to deal with ISIS. And I think the choice for us is not whether we're going to have to deal with them. The choice is, do we deal with them now while they're still kind of scattered? Or do we deal with them in 10 years or 5 years when they control a piece of land, they have their own country, and they use it to plan and carry out attacks that kill Americans here and around the world?
Rubio will surely play up his hawkish views if he runs for president. As for Kentucky Senator Rand Paul, he's also thinking about running for president. He came here touting his pro-life credentials, complete with a video before his introduction. He's a bit on the defensive after he recently said how Republicans might need to agree to disagree on social issues.
I don't want to change our platform. We need to be the pro-life party, the pro-traditional marriage party. But can we accept people, some people who don't agree with on those issues in the party? I think if we are not so strident to push people away, maybe having some people in the party who don't all agree with us, maybe we'll have a chance to persuade them, and we'll be a bigger party.
One item all these speakers agree upon is that religious liberty is under attack, whether through Obamacare here at home or abroad, where Christians are being persecuted for their faith. This crowd also agrees that they don't want to see a Hillary Clinton presidency. Congresswoman Michelle Bachmann told us that would be a nightmare.
She will be Barack Obama's third and fourth term of fundamentally transforming the United States of America away from the constitutional principles that the founders bled and died to give us.
It is those founders' principles that the 1,000-plus people in this room are fighting for. The goal for them now is to mobilize other voters of faith to make a difference at the ballot box. The polling shows that when evangelical Christians show up, they can make the difference. David Brody, CBN News, Washington.
Pat, those were some pretty big players in front of a critically important voting block.
Well, they really are. Ralph Reed, I had the Christian Coalition. I put him on as executive director, and he's moved on to start something like the Christian Coalition, except it's doing a very good job. Ralph is a very adroit political figure, and this is an important block. I think the big thing is that we can't have bomb throwers, and I think some of those who are considered Tea Party they're not quite sure what they're doing, and they don't have leadership, and as a result, they can cause sometimes more harm than good, so we're just not sure. Sometimes it's good, sometimes it's not good. But the country is clearly in the wrong direction, and people feel that. But I tell you, something else is in the wrong direction, is the Presbyterian Church USA. You talk about screwballs, it's bad. John has that story.
Pat, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is criticizing the Presbyterian Church USA for the decision to sell its stock in U.S. businesses in the West Bank. Netanyahu said Israel is the one democracy in the Middle East that protects human rights, including those of Christians. He said the vote should trouble all people of conscience because it was so, quote, disgraceful. And he had a recommendation for the Presbyterians.
You know, I would suggest to this Presbyterian organization is to fly to the Middle East, come and see Israel for the embattled democracy that it is, and then take a bus tour. Go to Libya, go to Syria, go to Iraq, and see the difference. And I would give them two pieces of advice. One is make sure it's an armor-plated bus. And second, don't say that you're Christians.
Netanyahu said he wonders why Israel had been singled out for such treatment. The U.S. World Cup soccer team can still advance to the next round in Brazil, even after Portugal's upsetting last-second goal in Sunday's game. After the first half, the U.S. was down 1-0, but an amazing strike by Jermaine Jones tied up the game. Then, in the 81st minute, Clint Dempsey scored to put the U.S. ahead 2-1. It looked like the U.S. was headed toward a guaranteed spot in the next round of 16 teams, but with just seconds left in the game, Portugal scored with a diving header. The U.S. will advance if it beats or ties Germany on Thursday. Well, churches in Brazil are mobilizing to reach soccer fans at the World Cup with the gospel. About 3 million international visitors will attend the games, and Christians are handing out literature with a message of hope. Some are also flashing this red card, similar to the cards used by soccer referees, but with a message warning against human trafficking.
Then there are the typical, you know, drama, dance, cultural exchange teams that are on the streets and ministering to the people. We have many, many different opportunities to also reach out to people in different languages. For example, you can now on your smartphone actually download 700 languages of the spoken New Testament.
The opportunity for sharing with World Cup visitors will continue through the championship game, which is scheduled for the 13th of July. And of course, Pat, CBN is doing work on the ground there with Operation Blessing, working to combat human trafficking.
Well, that's exactly right. Operation Blessing has got a huge plan going to reach out to millions of people during those games. And unfortunately, there are thousands of young girls who have been trafficked. And so these people who come to those games are not necessarily just there for sport. They're there for some sex as well. And the sex is involving young girls who have been taken from their families. And so CBN, or I should say Operation Blessing, is sending out a video that is very beautiful called One Reel. Oh, maybe it's One Real, I don't know. And there's so many things being done. But if you want to participate, it's CBN Center, Virginia Beach, Virginia 23463, Operation Blessing International. One of the things that it does to reach those less fortunate. John?
Pat, not getting enough sleep can be bad for your health. A lack of sleep is tied to obesity, high blood pressure, type 2 diabetes, depression, heart attacks, strokes, and even possible premature death. USA Today reports that the Centers for Disease Control call insufficient sleep a public health epidemic. One expert tells the paper sleep is one of the three keys to health, along with the right nutrition and exercise. And for tips on how you can get good sleep, you can go to cbnnews.com. And Pat, you're one of the healthiest guys I know. Can you let everyone know if you're getting enough sleep at night?
Well, man, I'm getting enough sleep. I also take naps from time to time. That's especially something you can do on Sunday afternoon. It used to be people that eat a big meal on Sunday, then they'd take a nap. And
yep, my grandma called it 20 winks.
20 winks. Well, it's good. My father lived a long, healthy life, and he always had, in his office, the secretary would say 30, and that meant he would go in and just nap for 30 minutes, and then he'd work out in the gym.
Very refreshing, yes.
But it's got to be done. And well, one more time, if you don't get if you get enough sleep, your body produces what's called leptin. Leptin reduces your appetite and causes you to lose weight. If you don't get enough sleep, your body produces something called ghrelin. And ghrelin makes you hungry. It makes you want to eat. And so low sleep means increased appetite, means more fat. So if nothing else, to lose weight, which everybody wants to do, is a desirable thing, go to bed early. Terry?
Well, coming up, meet a couple who adopted an embryo.
We feel like we honored God because we did adopt an embryo that already existed. We had nothing to do with her creation. She needed a home. We needed a child.
Their child is now 15 years old, and she'll tell what it's like to be a snowflake baby after this.
Want to be more involved in your child's education?
Since starting online school and being at home, his whole demeanor has changed.
No matter what your student needs, an online school program powered by K-12 could be your answer.
The K-12 curriculum can work for any child at any level.
It's made me more independent, more self-motivated, and it allowed me to succeed beyond what I thought I was capable of.
K-12 is individualized to fit any student, including advanced learners and students from kindergarten to college prep.
When I want to finish 5 lessons in one day, I can do it.
K-12 has an award-winning curriculum delivered by state-certified teachers. It's a public school option, so it's tuition-free, and it's designed to help parents be an active participant.
Parents are advocates for their students. They want to do what's best.
It's a commitment, and it's something that, you know, you have to embrace if you think that that's the best learning environment for them.
94% of K-12 parents say their student has benefited academically. Call or visit k12.com today for your free information kit.
Tuesday, free speech for me, but not for thee.
There are some views that are just so awful that they shouldn't even be heard on campuses.
hear what's behind the latest push to silence conservatives. Plus, a patient dead.
Doctors had concluded that he definitely died.
What happened next can't be explained by science. Tuesday on the 700 Club.
In our area here, there's a famous clinic, the Jones Clinic. Very dedicated people. I met them years and years ago. They've been in business for a long time. Famous all over the country in trying to help couples conceive children. And it's a lovely thing that they're doing. But in order to conceive, what is done is there's a marrying together of the father's sperm and the mother's egg, and they create an embryo in a test tube. And then that embryo is implanted in the woman, and then she hopefully bears the child and comes to term, and they have a beautiful baby. But what happens to those other embryos that are formed in those test tubes? Well, some of them are just thrown in the trash heap, or they're burned up, or they put in storage or something. But, I mean, they're really people. They're just little people waiting to be born. And they're, as I said, frozen in storage in labs and clinics across America. Thousands of embryos, unborn babies, left over from very fine fertility treatments. And these embryos are usually donated to science or they're destroyed. But as our Caitlin Burke reports, a Christian adoption agency is offering another option, a chance for these embryos to become human beings and be born.
Welcome to the Nightlight Christian Adoption Agency, home to the Snowflake Program.
The Snowflake Program is an embryo adoption program that allows people who have embryos in frozen storage to offer those embryos to another couple for adoption.
When a couple chooses to freeze their embryos, they're stored in cryotanks like these. There's no limit on how long an embryo can be frozen. Some have even been stored for more than 15 years and still resulted in successful pregnancies.
John and Marlene Strieg became the first couple to adopt an embryo through the Snowflake Program.
We feel like we honored God because we did adopt an embryo that already existed. We had nothing to do with her creation. She needed a home. We needed a child.
Three adopted embryos were transferred to Marlene on April 11, 1998. On December 31st, Hannah was born.
When I saw her, I just thought that she was the most beautiful baby I'd ever seen.
Now a healthy and happy 15-year-old, Hannah learned about her unique story at an early age.
She was about five and in kindergarten, and they were planting seeds. My mom had bought this package of seeds, and she planted them and froze them, and she's like, that was you. You were frozen. You were a frozen seed. And they put that seed in my tummy to grow. So she had that visualization and visual concept of a seed and how tiny a seed is. And she was so tiny. And I used to say, and only God could see you. You were so tiny. And she used to say, Mommy, tell me that's part of the story again. Tell me about how tiny I was.
Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest.
Once you have your child, all the pieces fit together. And you're going, oh, that's where my child was at.
On average, one snowflake baby is born every 10 days. Still, there are a very limited number of people who know about frozen embryo adoption, and the number of embryos going into storage continues to rise.
We believe that life begins at conception, which means as soon as the embryo is created. And for many of these, or for these embryos, they've been placed in frozen storage, and that process of developing, being born, growing into adulthood, has been halted and interrupted.
Tom and Annabelle Peterson wanted life for their extra embryos. After years of trying to get pregnant, they were successful with in vitro and then blessed with a surprise.
Our firstborn was Andy, and we had him in 2007. So after that, a year after Andy was born, I found out I was pregnant.
After the birth of their second son, Lucas, the Petersons decided to stop trying to conceive. But God had other plans.
So a year later, after Lucas was born, I found out I was pregnant with Louisa. So In 4 years, we had 3 kids.
Still, 6 of Tom and Annabelle's embryos remained frozen. After much individual prayer, they decided together to donate those embryos for adoption.
It would break my heart knowing that I was giving up on the child and letting go of the child, and it broke my heart. But then I realized, and it just came to me, is that that's my selfishness.
It's almost like I heard a voice, or call it a conscious thought, or God speaking to me. They're not yours, Annabelle. And that thought just came to my heart, and it just gave me such peace.
God matched Tom and Annabelle's donated embryos with parents that could give them life. Meet Amos. He's biologically the Petersons, but his parents are Bert and Karina.
They're just wonderful people. Oh my goodness, they're so happy, and just seeing them with that child and just knowing what they're experiencing, and it's just beautiful.
Amos's parents agreed to an open adoption, so Tom and Annabelle are able to watch as he grows.
You have so much joy and so much peace from your decision, but is there still some pain?
When he gets old enough and sees that, he realizes that that's not his biological dad, and he's going to go, well, who's my real biological parents? And if he has this thought that, like, his parents don't love him, didn't love him, and they gave him up, it's like, I think about that, I'm like,
that hurts.
It's so far from the truth, because I love the kid so much, and it's not even, I mean, I don't even, not the father to the kid, but I love him so much, and that pains me that he might experience that.
Tom and Annabelle say that just as with the children they gave birth to, they've always loved their embryos, and it's because of that love that they chose to give them life. Caitlin Burke, CBN News, San Diego, California.
That's a beautiful story, but you know, it raises some issues. You know, how does a man get attached to his sperm, you know?
Well, it's more than sperm. You said yourself it's life then.
Well, it's life, but still it's a little tiny seed. And how do you get attached to that so that you start to cry about it? I mean, it's amazing. But I don't like the idea of the one who donate the embryo suddenly knows who they are. They watch all the way through. Then the kid's got to say, well, these are my birth daddies and these are my other daddies. And I think it'd be better just to, you know, let them go.
I think it's, you know, I think it's a responsible thing that this couple has done. And I think it's a new world. You know, there have been open adoptions for a long time with babies that weren't snowflake babies. So open adoptions where the child actually, you know, has knowledge of and from time to time meets the parents. I think it takes that kind of lostness out of a child's history, you wonder, where was I? Why did this happen? I do. I think why I think so many kids look for their parents when they're older.
You're the mother of a multitude, so you
know.
Well,
I haven't always made those choices, but I do think there are lots of questions in a child's heart as they get older.
Of course they are, and it's nice to know. But all right. Mm-hmm. But this is, as I say, a brave new world. You know, there was the whole idea of, you know, George Bush talking about, you know, the whole concept of gene splitting and embryo, you're looking at the implantation of some of these, you know, genes and so forth. The idea was it would kill a life if they used these for experimentation, and the ethical issues are enormous.
Sure.
And, you know, people say, okay, the morning after pill, a man or woman, they have sex, and conception takes place, and then there's a pill that kills the unborn child, but it's not an abortion, but they say it's an abortion. So they sell those things over the counter. So what do? Do you regulate that? I mean, it's a... Well, we are, as Terry said, entering into a brave new world.
We are. We're there.
Yeah,
we're
past there.
Yes.
But the thing that concerns me, though, is you take an embryo and then you begin to manipulate the embryo and you try to make some super race out of it. So you're going to inject certain kinds of muscle tissue, or you're going to inject some kind of brain tissue. And so somebody's Dr. Strangelove has got this little teeny thing, and I think they're playing
God. that brings another whole element to the.
But it'll be there. And then they're trying to clone. They want to clone. They've got a sheep they've cloned. Now they want to clone human beings, and that's kind of horrifies people. Ladies and gentlemen, we need an ethical standard to judge these things. But all I can say is what Caitlin was showing you, it is a beautiful thing for those unborn children as embryos to be given a mother and a father and given them a life. You decide. Let the Lord show you. Terry.
Well, up next, he was a bodybuilder, a model, and an actor. But most of all, he was a player.
Sex became more of like a conquest and outlet. It was, how many can I put on my belt? How many notches can I get?
Question is coming up.
Pat Boone here with a word about bank safety. Do you think your money is safe in the bank? Don't bank on it. A generation ago, bank accounts felt secure and they paid interest. This encouraged the virtue of thrift and saving. But today, bank accounts pay virtually nothing, and they've shifted from low risk to high risk. For example, did you know your money deposited in most U.S. banks could be subject to limited withdrawal and even confiscation? Oh, yes. And that's just the first of 19 risks explained in a new white paper entitled, Don't Bank on It. You still think your bank deposits are safe? You better get this vital new Don't Bank on It white paper now. Call the number on the screen or visit SwissAmerica.com, the gold standard. Learn how simple it is to become your own banker today.
Hello friends, Wink Martindale here for 1-800-MEDIGAP, America's trusted source for Medicare supplemental insurance. You know, it's fun to take chances if you're on a game show, but in the real world, if you're turning 65 or already have Medicare Part A and Part B, call 1-800-MEDIGAP. My friends at 1-800-MEDIGAP can help protect you and save you money on Medicare supplemental insurance. Don't take a chance. Tell them Wink sent you when you call 1-800-MEDIGAP today.
Macho man, muscles, handsome, chiseled jaw, rock hard abs. Washboard abs, as they say. They'd stop him on the street and say, you ought to be in TV, you ought to be in movies, you ought to be a model. And before long, they got him, he was so good looking, they put him on magazine covers. And then he had TV and movie roles. And also, he had so many women falling over him, he didn't know what to do.
John Turk had what it took to be a successful bodybuilder and model. The drive, the build, and the look. There was only one thing missing.
I didn't really, you know, believe in God per se. At the time, I thought I was my own God.
John was raised by a Muslim father and Christian mother, but had no interest in either religions.
I wanted to play sports. I wanted to do this or that. And I just kind of, anything that got in the way of that, I threw it aside.
John was always driven to be the best and preferred to compete on his own terms.
I'm very, very type A personality. I like to be in control of things. But if it's a team sport, I feel like the power was taken away from me because I can't control what someone else does.
Later in his 20s, he became a successful bodybuilder. That and his looks brought a lot of attention, and now he was more concerned about his image, even when he was working as a Chicago police officer.
I would get a comment like, oh, you're not a cop, you look like you should be on a soap opera, or, you know, you're not a cop, you look like Superman.
John started pursuing acting and modeling and eventually left the police force. He landed small roles in film and television and appeared in fitness magazines. He also became the face of Sub-Zero from the video game Mortal Kombat. He had many admirers, especially women.
It was, how many can I put on my belt? How many notches can I get?
But that, he says, started getting old.
Found my heart stripped and broken, a little unsettled.
It's just like, after a while, sex became more of like a conquest and outlet, and it felt to me dirty. I got tired of playing the game, and I just got on my knees and I looked up and I said, God, I don't want to do this anymore, but I'm asking you to please help me find the person I'm going to marry.
2 weeks later, he met Julia.
And I knew right from the minute I met her, she was the one, and I felt like not only did I have a girlfriend, but I felt like I had a best friend, which I didn't feel I had any other relationships.
The couple married 2 years later, and even though he believed God had answered his prayers, he had no interest in a relationship with him.
And I treated him like a cosmic genie. I rubbed the lamp when I wanted something, and he made it appear, and then I, hey, see you later, and I forgot about him.
That was about to change. Julia began experiencing what his mother-in-law insisted were demonic attacks.
We would sleep in and I would turn over, and literally in the middle of the night, she would be staring at me, and when I would look at her, she would growl, and she'd just anger and hate in her eyes like I've never seen before. And we never listened to Christian music, but she constantly kept playing this Christian music, and when we got in the car, she'd play it, and then all of a sudden she'd say, turn it off, and she'd get really violent, and it would upset her extremely, especially when Jesus was mentioned or anything like that.
One night, Julia jumped from the car while John was driving. He committed her to a psychiatric hospital.
I couldn't take it anymore, and I looked up and I said to God, if you're real, I need help. I can't do this. I can't fix this.
The episode passed and Julia came home.
She would really engross herself in the Word and would constantly pray and constantly pray.
Julia told John they needed to give their lives to Christ.
We sat down on a couch one day and she says, Hon, you know, you need to give your life to the Lord. I asked Jesus to come into my life and I repented for my sins.
They found a church and began the process of allowing God into their lives.
I don't think you can really put into words the love of the Lord because it's so deep. And I think about all the things that I've done in my life, but he was still there.
Meanwhile, the attacks on Julia stopped.
He helped my wife with her situation and created that miracle. And I started to create a journal. And as things would happen, I'm like, that's a miracle from God. I know it is.
He's also learned to put God first.
That aspect of it's all about me was gone. And I just let God lead my life. I let him direct it.
And he became comfortable with God's love.
He wants that relationship with you. He wants you to rely on him. He wants you to give it up to him so you can have that peace.
You know, the thing that story tells to me, and it should tell to you, is that no amounts of charm, no amounts of glamour, no amounts of body fitness can handle a demon. You're not able to do it. Demonic power is beyond your power. Beyond your power. The devil is strong, as Martin Luther sang, put in the song, A Mighty Fortress. He's armed with cruel hate, and on earth is not his equal. We don't have an equal to Satan in the strength of our arms or our legs or our brains or our money. We don't have it. Only Jesus Christ can overcome the power of Satan. And he does it. He is more powerful than Satan. And if he comes into your heart, then you are more powerful than Satan. The least Satan, the kingdom of God, has more power than Satan if he's in Jesus. Because Jesus is God Almighty, and he has all authority in heaven and earth. Now, I don't know what's happened to you, but in John's case, his wife was demonic, demon-possessed. Began to scream and growl. Why? Because there are demons in the world. They are real. But Jesus Christ has power over them. Now, are you having these black thoughts at night? Do you want to commit suicide? Have you had unexplained things happen in your body or in your home or in your family? Things you can't handle? Have you had those experiences? Well, let me tell you, you need Jesus. We all need Jesus, but you especially need him to set you free and to come into your life. And right now, I want to pray with you, and I want you to pray with me these words. Lord Jesus Christ. That's right, pray with me. Lord Jesus Christ, you know the spiritual battle that is taking place. And I know that only you can give victory. And so, Lord Jesus, right now, I ask you, come into my heart. Live your life in me. And give me power over all the works of the enemy. In Jesus' name, I declare victory. Thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. If you prayed with me just then, I want you to do something. I want you to call. We've got folks on the phones who love you. They care about you. And I want to send you something called A New Day. It'll tell you about the life you've just begun. And more than anything, though, you need to say, I've prayed with Pat. I've given my heart to the Lord. And get somebody praying with you right now who loves Jesus. The number is toll-free, 1-800-759-0700. Here's Terry.
Well, coming up later, we've got your email. Tiffany says, my husband and I need a biblical reason to have a circumcision performed on our son because we know of no other legitimate reason to perform the procedure. Can you lead me to passages in the Bible that will help us understand which direction we should go? Pat's going to answer this question and more when we bring it on.
You're just thinking about one thing, the money and your selfish means and what you want. And when you're at that place, you're in a dangerous place. When I should have been killed in the streets, you didn't allow that to happen. He showed me mercy, even when I didn't deserve it. Oh, when I realized how much God loved me, that compelled me to love him back. It compelled me to love him back.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, God, how do I do this? Where do I do this? Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
Welcome back to Washington for this CBN Newsbreak. Jill Duggar of the show 19 Kids and Counting got married Saturday. The 23-year-old bride married Derek Dillard in front of more than 1,000 family and friends at the Cross Church in Springdale, Arkansas. And the two had their first kiss after they exchanged their vows. Derek has called her, quote, the girl of his dreams. CBN is helping hundreds of children in need in Thailand as they get ready to go back to school. 240 school children from low-income farming families in a remote area of northern Thailand attended a recent CBN back-to-school event. Children received school supplies like backpacks, notebooks, and lunchboxes. They were also invited to watch the David episode of Superbook. The response was positive. One young student said he learned that God is with David, so he has a brave heart, and that if we are with God, no matter where we are, God is with us too. Out of the mouths of babes. Well, you can find out more about what CBN is doing around the world by logging on to cbn.com/international. Pat and Terry will be back right after this.
At 69, I'm starting a whole new chapter in my life.
Lifestyle Lift, a life-changing procedure that helps remove wrinkles, frown lines, and sagging skin on your face and neck.
I have a younger look and a new look on life.
Look, almost 200,000 lives changed. Lifestyle Lift is the affordable way to looking years younger.
Nothing's better than a lifestyle lift.
Don't miss your chance for your free skin-firming treatment. Call now, because this amazing offer ends soon.
Every time I see somebody, you look so good, you just never aged, I go, oh, thank you for that, you know.
Would you feel good looking younger and more attractive?
I haven't felt this good in years.
My name is Cindy, I'm 56, but nobody needs to know.
Don't miss your chance for your free skin-firming treatment. Call now, because this amazing offer ends soon. Call 1-800-493-3762 today. Don't regret looking older than you feel.
Tuesday, free speech for me, but not for thee.
There are some views that are just so awful that they shouldn't even be heard on campuses.
Hear what's behind the latest push to silence conservatives. Plus, a patient dead.
Doctors had concluded that he definitely died.
What happened next can't be explained by science. Tuesday on the 700 Club.
To see this week's top on-demand videos, go to cbn.com.
Time to bring it on with your email questions. And Pat, this first one is from Tiffany, who says, I have 8 weeks remaining of my second pregnancy, and this time it will be a boy. My husband and I need a biblical reason to have a circumcision performed on our son because we know of no other legitimate reason to perform the procedure. Can you lead me to passages in the Bible that will help us understand which direction we should go?
Well, you can look at Exodus and you see what was required. You also see when the children of Israel moved into the Promised Land, one of the things they did was circumcise the males. But that was a sign of the covenant between God and Israel. And circumcision doesn't mean anything, but in terms of the Christian. But you want a reason. I'll give you a reason, and it's called cervical cancer. It turns out, if I'm right, and I'm sure somebody will say, you don't know what you're talking about, which is entirely possible, but it's my understanding that men who are not circumcised have a tendency to have wives who get cervical cancer because they have, buildup of various types of viruses that cause that. So that's the reason. But you're not entering into the covenant that God made with Abraham. That was the covenant. It's this covenant sign of the people of Israel.
I think there are a number of people today who are questioning, do we do this, don't we do this?
Well, I've never heard that about pain for little cancer. Kids. It used to be, it was a standard thing. Every little baby got circumcised. It was mm-hmm. just done and done and it was done.
Yes.
I still think it's important, and I do think cervical cancer is a major, major problem. Now, maybe some of the medical people say that's not true, but I think it is.
Well, and if you are going to circumcise your child, you need to do it when they're...
Oh, yeah, later
days
on,
old.
Forget it.
Yeah.
I mean, it's really very mm-hmm. painful. A little kid didn't, I mean, a little baby, I mean, it may hurt, but he didn't know any better.
Mm-hmm. Okay, this is Jennifer Pat, who says, I love watching your show. I'm Catholic and I'm struggling with the concept of forgiveness. As you know, my denomination requires going to confession in order for your sins to be forgiven. I'll admit I've lived a horrible, sinful life up until now. And there are some sins that while I can admit them to God, I can't bring myself to admit or confess them to a priest. Will I still be forgiven? How do I accept the forgiveness when I'm filled with doubt that God really forgives me?
All right. As you know, I am Baptist, Protestant, whatever, and I don't want to get crosswise with my Catholic friends because I really admire and love Catholic people. But the Bible says very clearly there is one intercessor between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. There is one intercessor. You do not need a priest standing between you and God. Jesus Christ is the intercessor between God and man. So you confess your sins to Him. Now, if you've hurt somebody, then you may need to go to that person and confess and ask forgiveness. But if it's just something that you've done and you're ashamed of, I think the confessional works very nicely because it unburdens people. They have somebody to talk to, but I don't know what you've done. I imagine it has something to do with sex. and it's something that, you know, you don't want to confess to a priest. All right, confess it to the Lord, take His forgiveness, and get on with your life, all right?
This is Michelle who says, how do I let go of anger? I want to move forward. I read the Bible and hear how if I let it go, it's great. I know if I can do this, all that I ask, I will receive. I know God is with me, but I don't hear Him.
Why do people have anger? They have anger because they have been offended. Why are they offended? It's because of self. Self. Bible talks about sarx, S-A-R-X, and that is translated flesh. The flesh gets mad because it is offended. There's only one way to deal with that is to let the old person die. We are crucified with Christ, and yet we are raised in newness of life. So you have to come to the point where you say, I am dead with Christ. And you have to make a conscious decision, I am dead. So if I'm dead, they can be standing over my grave just saying terrible things about me, and I won't feel a thing because I'm down in that cold box and nothing's getting to me. So when you're dead, you're dead to the old, the slights and the things that upset you. But you've got to do it. And Paul said, I die daily. So every day you confess, you say, Lord, today I surrender myself to You. I am dead to the old man. I'm alive to God. Every day. And then fill your mind with the Word of God, not with the slights that come about. Most of that slights are just petty nonsense anyhow. Okay.
This is Jan Pat who says, in the Old Testament were instances of the Lord causing armies to be confused and fighting their own, allowing for their defeat. Do you think that the Lord might be causing the Iraqis to lay down arms for His own purpose?
I tell you, I think mainly they were laying them down because there are a bunch of Sunnis coming against them, and the Shiites don't quite know what to do. But yes, some of that confusion, I don't know about the Iraqi army, but that used to happen, that God would send confusion into the enemies, and He'll do it into the enemies that come against you. You know, the Bible says, touch not mine anointed and do my prophets no harm. And I have seen people that have come against me and horrible things have happened to them. Horrible, and I mean horrible. So the Bible says, vengeance is mine, I'll repay, says the Lord. So, we don't have to fight our battles. We don't have to go to war against others. But confusion of troops, yes. I talked to an Israeli officer who told me miraculous things that happened when he was in the front lines up on the Golan Heights. Miraculous. The enemy saw angels. They saw beings, and they fled in terror. I mean, yes, it still happens today, but whether it happened in Iraq, I can't say. I just don't know. I'm not qualified.
Possible, though.
Okay.
Well, up next, she didn't drink, she didn't do drugs, and she didn't sleep around. Still, she got the AIDS virus.
I was like, oh, God, why you allow to stop? Why did you allow to stop?
Hear how she survived against all odds when we return.
How can you have wisdom to solve problems you face? How can you look at problems and see opportunities? How can you be a part of God's plan today? Living Under God's Blessing, featuring the 3-time Emmy-nominated series, Made in Israel. Available now.
Ready to pay less for long-distance home phone service and get more? Vonage is just $9.99 a month for a full 6 months. That's our best offer ever. Visit Vonage online, sign up now, and get more than 25 great calling features. Vonage is a home phone service that lets you call from your home or mobile phone. If you're ready to get more from your home phone service and pay less, visit Vonage online or call today.
Well, when doctors told Elizabeth Charity that she had the AIDS virus, they also said it was just a matter of time before it killed her. But Elizabeth had a different opinion. She thought it was just a matter of time before she was healed.
I met Oliver just walking down the street one day, and it's like I knew him, but I didn't really know him.
Liz Charity was a single woman who wasn't looking for a relationship, but then she met Oliver. It wasn't long before they were happily married, but 3 years later, his health started to fail.
I began to see symptoms of this man falling off, losing weight. He was getting very sick, and that's when God told me to start praying for him.
But Oliver refused to go to a doctor. Eventually, Liz also started having health issues.
I got in rashes, and I was feeling sort of sickly. And that's when I went in for a physical.
Liz was not prepared for what she would hear next. She and her husband had AIDS. She contracted the virus from him, and they had less than a year to live.
I was thinking, God, why you allow to stop? Why did you allow to stop?
Her son Antoine remembers when his mom told him.
I was hurt. I was scared. In denial, I said, no, it's not my mother. You know, she didn't sleep around, she didn't party, she didn't drink, she didn't smoke. Why my mother, God?
Her husband eventually died from a brain infection. As the months passed, the disease ravaged Liz's immune system and her body. Dr. David Wheeler remembers meeting her for the first time.
She had pretty advanced disease and had lost a lot of weight, had some evidence of a suppressed immune system with, I think I recall, maybe yeast infection in her mouth, and really quite debilitated.
She and her two sons prayed for a miracle.
I asked God, you know, let your will be done in my mom's life, heal her body, you know, add years to her life.
Then she learned she had a brain infection, the same thing that killed her husband.
During that time, I really went into prayer, and I said, Lord, I know you said that you would heal me. So I go have to totally trust you to heal me.
Soon the infection cleared up. However, she still had to take medication to build her immune system, but the medicine had severe side effects.
That medicine that I was taking, it had me to break out in hives. I was swollen and I was sick. It was like I could hardly get myself out of the bed.
Dr. Wheeler gave Liz a new antiretroviral therapy to fight the virus and rebuild her immune system. She believes the treatment was an answer to prayer.
My immune system began to heal. It was a continued rapidly healing. I heard the Holy Spirit speak to me, and he said, I have sustained you until this medicine was made.
Doctors were amazed that even after she was given 1 year to live, Liz survived two more years, and now she is healthy again.
She was able to recover the immune system, gain the weight back. Her body then fought off these annoying opportunistic conditions. And all the time that her doctors could check the blood sample and see that the virus was still undetectable.
And today the virus is still undetectable. Liz is down from taking a dozen pills a day to only one. Throughout the entire ordeal, Liz believed that God would make a way for her to be healed.
Even at that time, when they were saying, you know, do you realize what you have? And that's when I told them, I know my God can heal me.
I told people they need three things. They need to take their medicines. They need someone to stick with them for 6 to 12 months, family member, spouse, friend, and they have to have that will to live. For a number of people, it's their spiritual life and their spiritual basis that supports them through that.
I know God still answers prayers, because my mom's a living miracle. She got an opportunity to see me get married. She had an opportunity to see me have two grandchildren that she loved to death. She just had an opportunity just to be here, you know. And I couldn't imagine her not being here at this time of my life.
For Liz, life has taken on a new meaning.
And I start enjoying the little things in life, like my grandchildren and my sons and my daughter-in-laws. And I love to take those long walks where God and I can commune and talk. It's so wonderful to be able to know that God loves me that much, that He was able to say, Liz, in spite of death, you could actually speak to it and say, move, and that you can continue to walk in the fullness of life because of the blood of Jesus.
God loves Liz that much, and He loves you that much, and we want to take some time to pray for you today. Here's another encouraging word to build your faith. This is Nancy from Belle, Florida, Pat, who was diagnosed with COPD in 2009. Mm. She struggled but continued to work in spite of the illness until 2010, when she had to stop because breathing became too difficult. Phone conversations could only last a few minutes, and then she'd be too out of breath to continue. She had to give herself a nebulizer treatment just to get through each day. And then, last March, she was watching this program and she heard you give a word of knowledge. You said, another lung condition is being healed by the power of God. Nancy placed her hands over her lungs and claimed that word for herself. That same day, she was able to breathe freely. Since then, she stopped taking nebulizer treatments. She's able to go outdoors, do gardening and other activities that were impossible for her to do before.
Praise God.
Amen.
Let's pray together. We serve a great God. Father, You are a great God. You rule over all heaven and all earth. There's nothing impossible with You. You are the great I Am. And we testify and affirm that You are God Almighty. Now, touch lives in this audience right now. In the name of Jesus, receive an answer to your prayers. May you know healing and deliverance and freedom. In Jesus' name,
yes.
Amen.
Amen
and amen.
Mm-hmm.
Call us if you want further prayer. It's time to us to say goodbye on this program, but our counselors are there with you, so the number is toll-free, 1-800-759-0700. Well, we leave you with today's Power Minute from Matthew 18:19. If two of you agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. Well, tomorrow, an MD discovers the cure for his aching soul. Until then, this is Pat Robertson for Terry and all of us saying goodbye, and may God bless you.
Tuesday, free speech for me, but not for thee.
There are some views that are just so awful that they shouldn't even be heard on campuses.
Hear what's behind the latest push to silence conservatives. Plus, a patient dead.
Doctors had concluded that he definitely died.
What happened next can't be explained by science. Tuesday on the 700 Club.
Just out of the blue, the pain would hit me and I would fall. My arches were falling, and I also had bone spurs, arthritis, and pneumosis, which is an infection of the foot. The 700 Club was on, and it was the last 10 minutes. Gordon Robertson came on.
There's a woman, you're saying, the soles of your feet, you've got problems with fallen arches. In both feet, it's very difficult for you to walk, very painful. God's healing you now.
I just had this supernatural knowledge that I was healed. So I stood up and just started jumping up and down like a rabbit, just rejoicing and laughing and crying and hysterical because the pain was gone. My feet weren't hurting, my legs weren't hurting, my hip wasn't hurting, my back wasn't hurting. And it was so remarkable. God just wanted me to know He was in the business of healing. He did complete what He started.